In 1947, a shepherd boy threw a stone into the mouth of a cave, a few feet up the side of a hill, and heard a tinkling of broken pottery. Climbed up and found one of these broken pots, many others around, and many scrolls. Right through history, there are reports of small pieces of literature found in the area blowing about, but this was the greatest find. Unfortunately, it was a time of great tension. It was the time when the United Nations were about to proclaim that Israel was a nation, and it was expected that the Arabs would immediately attack the Jews. The first copies of the Dead Sea Scrolls, as they came to be known, was bought in the middle of the night through the barbed wire from an Arab merchant and an Israeli scholar who risked their lives to make the transaction, but they were more interested, one in the scholarship and the other in the price, than they were in the local politics. The Dead Sea Scrolls were the literature of the Essene sect, who had a monastery nearby. And amongst the thousands of fragments were found copies of every book in the Old Testament, some quite small, but one complete copy of the book of Isaiah. Until the Dead Sea Scrolls were found, the oldest Hebrew text of the Old Testament was the Masoretic text, about the 10th century AD. And this immediately took the text back 1,000 years. And it was fascinating to compare the Essene text with the Masoretic text. And the differences were very slight indeed. There are people who object that the Bible must have been copied over and over again, and therefore errors must have crept in. But this assumes that every generation of copies died out at the same time. Obviously, of course, they overlapped, and new copies could be checked by the many existing copies. If you were to read a copy of Shakespeare and it said to be or not to be, that's the problem, you'd immediately say, "Ah, no, that's wrong. This copy says not the question." And so the new copies easily verified from the old ones. And the Essene text showed that indeed our script of the Old Testament had been passed down very faithfully indeed. It was the Jewish custom in New Testament times to inter the body of a deceased relative and then go back perhaps a year, 18 months later, and gather together the bones and put them in one of these earthenware boxes known as an ossuary. This one is particular interest. It's inscribed to the effect that it contained the bones of Nicanor, the Alexandrian, who made the gates. Josephus tells us that the bronze gates of the temple, made by Nicanor, were so beautiful that they were valued above the gates that were covered in gold. No doubt Nicanor was the man who made the gate beautiful, where Peter and John found the lame man and raised him, walking and leaping and shouting into the temple. This beautifully made ossuary is interesting because the lid has a motif which is set to represent Solomon's porch in the Temple of Jerusalem. If that is so, it's the only indication that we have of the architecture of the temple in Jerusalem. This prism, an extremely important prism, was found by Henry Layard, not in Nineveh, but in somebody's library, being used as a candlestick. He got it off the gentleman and presented it to the museum. It is the most complete record existing of Esarhaddon's campaigns. He was the son of Sennacherib, And he defeated Taharqa and conquered the delta of Egypt, and Taharqa rebelled against him. But amazing that this priceless contemporary record of those days should be used as a candlestick. In the days of Isaiah, the northern kingdom of Israel and the Aramaeans of Damascus allied together to plunder Jerusalem and to plunder Judah and Jerusalem. Isaiah advised the king Ahaz that in quietness and confidence would be his strength, but instead he sent off a large sum of money to Tiglath-Pileser to buy his help. Tiglath-Pileser only too pleased to oblige, and he besieged Damascus and so relieved the pressure on Jerusalem. This tablet is very interesting. It records the tribute that Ahaz paid, and of course after that Judah had signed on the Assyrian Insurance Fund, the Insurance Society, and forever after they would be vassals of the Assyrians and have to acknowledge the Assyrian gods. One very interesting thing is that on this tablet, the king of Judah is called Jehoahaz. And it seems that the Old Testament writers were so disgusted with his betrayal of Judah to the Assyrians that they refused to use the prefix in honor of Yahweh, calling him Jehoahaz. They cut that and he comes down to us just as Ahaz. This was the tin hat of the soldier of Old Testament times, worn by soldiers of all the warring parties, and the shape of it, very good defense against arrows which would glance off it. Also interesting in that most of the effigies of Baal that have survived show him wearing this kind of warrior's tin hat, this bronze helmet, the equivalent of a soldier's tin hat. From prehistoric times right up until the present day, there's been animosity between Iran and Iraq, Mesopotamia and the hills of Persia. In the early days, it was Elam. Persia was Elam. And in the days of the Sumerians, the Elamites were a thorn in the side of the people of Mesopotamia. They looked upon them as weird and strange people. They had a very interesting political system, a very efficient way of training up the new kings. And the Sumerians had a proverb illustrating the grumpiness and the way in which an Elamite could never be satisfied. They used to say that an Elamite is unhappy because he's only got a house to live in. Ashurbanipal decided to settle Elam once and for all, and after a propitious astrological revelation, he sent his armies on campaign to Elam. Tremendous battles took place. He defeated the Elamites and set up his own king in Elam. We've got the new king being introduced over here. Here the new king is being presented to the subjected Elamites by an Assyrian official, and down below in the river Ulai, the debris of the battle floating past. Rather interesting in that the river Ulai was where Daniel had his vision after fasting for 3 weeks. The victory over Elam was a great triumph for Ashurbanipal, but the cost in manpower and drain on the national economy was such that it undermined the stability of Assyria. And Ashurbanipal ended his days in misery. There's a tablet somewhere in the museum which has been described as the Assyrian Job. It says something like this: "Oh, woe is me, everybody's against me. I've always worshipped the gods and I've been a good king, and yet everybody's plotting behind my back, and I keep getting taken ill, nothing's going right, poor me." And so Ashurbanipal, who came to the throne with great joy, he entered his father's harem and became one of the greatest of the Assyrian kings, ended his days in misery, and after bringing Assyria to its zenith in power and prestige, set it up for its downfall. Of the literally miles of Assyrian reliefs, this is said to be the only peaceful scene. It shows Ashurbanipal feasting in his garden with his favourite wife. Date trees loaded with dates and the vine heavy with grapes, richly dressed slaves are fanning and keeping him cool. The cook's bringing in his latest dish, and this lady is gently playing the harp in the background. An idyllic pastoral scene. But so that his mind doesn't go too far from the real affairs of life, there's the head of King Temt-Humban of Elam hanging in the bushes. This is Sargon II, who succeeded eventually Tiglath-Pileser. Tiglath-Pileser was immediately succeeded by Shalmaneser, who besieged Samaria. But Sargon took the credit of finishing the siege, and we don't know what happened to Shalmaneser. The record carries with Sargon as king. This great slab could well be inscribed Isaiah chapter 20. Isaiah chapter 20 verse 1 dates one of Isaiah's prophecies as in the year that Sargon sent Tartan to Ashdod to subdue it. Ashdod had rebelled against the Assyrians, and Sargon sent his second in command, the Tartan, to punish Ashdod. And this is a slab showing Sargon giving instructions to his second in command, the Tartan. Sargon built the most pretentious palace that had yet been built. He designed a special city, a mile square, to service the palace. And the palace itself was built on an artificial mound 50 feet high. Inscribed over the doorway, there was a prayer to the gods that he might live a long life and that the palace might be filled with booty from the cities of the mountains and cities of the plain. Unfortunately, within a few months of the housewarming, Sargon suffered a very stabbing pain in his back. The records say that a warrior entered the Assyrian camp and slew the king. So Sargon perished, the empire was thrown into upheaval as Sennacherib tried to take over and reorganize things. We've seen the account of Sennacherib's invasion of Judah from the Taylor Prism. There are no less than five accounts of that campaign. This was one of the early ones to be read. It was a slab from between the legs of one of these even bigger giant bulls, and it was read in situ by Hincks, the Irish clergyman, who was one of the team that first deciphered cuneiform. And you can imagine what satisfaction he got as he read the slab. It gives the tribute that Hezekiah paid to Sennacherib, and to his delight, he found that on this slab, the amount of gold recorded was exactly the same as that recorded in the Bible. The amount of silver was double, but it was exactly double, which indicates that there was a correlation, but probably measured by a special weight for silver. Like the Taylor Prism, this account says how Sennacherib's terror so overwhelmed Hezekiah's army that all his mercenary troops deserted him. If you've ever wondered why there was a den of lions for Daniel to be thrown in, it was part of their religion. The king, every year at a festival, had to show his supremacy not only over the human empire, but over the kingdom of the animals. And the lion, of course, was the king of the animal kingdom. And by killing lions, the ruler showed that he was supreme over nature as well. Ashurbanipal claimed to have killed, I think it was 70 lions on foot, not from the safety of a chariot, but by getting the lion by the beard and running his sword through it. Must have taken quite a bit of nerve. Not my scene. Here at the annual festival of the lion slaying, the royal family have gathered together on a hill to watch the king showing his valour and supremacy over the whole universe. These reliefs from the palace of Sennacherib show in great detail the siege of Lachish by Sennacherib. The Bible tells us that from Lachish, Sennacherib sent up Rabsari and Rabshakeh to Jerusalem to try and get Jerusalem to surrender without a battle. Here the siege is taking place, and first of all, archers are sending up a volley of arrows, followed by slingers sending a volley of stones. Then there'll be another volley of arrows, another volley of stones, and so the defenders will be driven back from the ramparts. Lachish was excavated by Starkey of the British Museum in the 1930s, and he found souvenirs of this Bible siege. And over here in this case, here are the actual arrowheads and the actual sling stones that were being used in the siege of Lachish, and also some date stones from one of the soldiers' lunches. And yet another detailed account of Sennacherib's campaigns, with the pictorial representations and the five detailed accounts, surely this is one of the most best authenticated historical events that is known. Far more detail about it from contemporary evidence than even things like Caesar's campaigns. We've only got his word for it. The Bible speaks about the ivory palace that Ahab built for Jezebel, wanted to make her feel at home. People didn't believe it could have been an ivory palace. Not an ivory palace, might have been whitewashed so that it looked sort of white like ivory, but Samaria was excavated and they found themselves shoveling up basketful after basketful of carved ivory. Ahab's ivory palace was an ivory palace. All the rooms were decorated with carved ivory. The French were preparing a welcome for Nelson and the British army by fortifying a fort at a place called Rosetta. And one of the soldiers found a very interesting stone. He reported it to his officer, Lieutenant Bouchard, who called in Napoleon's scholars. They quickly recognized it was important because there were three panels. The bottom one was in Greek, the middle one in another script, the top one in hieroglyphs, the amazing picture writing that was puzzling everyone. Napoleon had rubbings made of the stone and copies sent to the universities of Europe, but when the French were defeated, all the treasures gathered by Napoleon's scholars, including the stone, fell into the hands of the British and came here to the British Museum. It was surmised that the three panels would be about the same subject. So from the Greek, which any scholar could read, it ought to be possible to eventually decipher the hieroglyphs. An English physicist named Young, who first propounded that light was transmitted in waves, he discovered that the sausage-shaped frames in the picture writing, the hieroglyphs, corresponded with the names of royalty in the Greek text. And he translated Ptolemy and Berenice. But there the work more or less ground to a halt. In France, a young lad aged 11 was shown some hieroglyphs by one of the scholars who told him, nobody can read this writing. And so this young lad, aged 11, dedicated his life to reading this writing, this amazing picture writing. Champollion. From the stone and from many other monuments, he, after 22 years, deciphered the hieroglyphs. But at the age of 17, he demonstrated to a learned society at Grenoble that the middle panel was a script closely associated with the Coptic scriptures, the Coptic church in Egypt, Christian community that had survived from New Testament times right through the Islamic period, had in fact fossilized the ancient Egyptian language, preserved the ancient Egyptian language. And he showed that this middle panel was very closely related to the Coptic script. But after 20 or so years, at last the hieroglyphs were deciphered, and immediately the perspective of history was dramatically changed. Instead of disappearing over the horizon at New Testament times, it went back 3,000, 4,000, 5,000 years, and scholars found themselves reading accounts of laborers building a pyramid who went on strike because of the quality of their rations and particularly the quality of their beer. We have been around the British Museum. We have seen over 100 pieces of evidence verifying the Bible as a reliable historical book. It seems that everywhere archaeology touches the Bible is vindicated as being a reliable record. And in fact, archaeologists who are studying the various areas take the Bible as a reliable source of information. Yago Yardine said he excavated Hatsor with the Bible in one hand and a spade in the other. In these days of postmodern confusion, there is an underlying hopelessness and an underlying despair. In these days, it is amazing that God has raised up such a testimony to the reliability of his word, not just as history. For instance, in the account of Sennacherib's invasion of Judah, the act of faith, the tremendous act of faith of Isaiah in refusing to surrender to Sennacherib is vindicated and shown to be a real event that actually happened under the providence of God. The Bible is not only reliable historically, the Bible has proved to be a basis on which we can relate to God. And the challenge in these days of confusion is to take the Bible seriously. Jesus said, seek and you shall find. And if we take the Bible seriously, read it, trust it, and obey its injunctions, there is an amazing relationship with God that's available, in which our lives can be flooded with His love, the wonderful experience of complete forgiveness, and the experience of being baptized in His Holy Spirit, so that His Word comes to life and glows and becomes relevant to everyday affairs today, not just history 2,500, 3,000 years ago. God bless you.